So, for this last week, we had two readings, the Ibn Masadra reading and the religion reading. Let's start with Ibn Masadra. So the focus of the Ibn Masadra reading is to prove that the use of reason for religious knowledge is okay. It might not sound like a big deal to us, but he uses this starting point to give us a lot of very interesting ideas. When he speaks about reason, he's speaking of inference. Inference is the idea of starting with what is before us in our experience and then working our way up to God. The other option is prophetic knowledge, that is revelation, and that comes from God and descends down to us. So the top-down approach is prophetic, and that's accepted, but the question now is whether the bottom-up approach of reason is also acceptable. Ibn Masadra starts his defense of reason by arguing that human intellect is given to us by God. Not a very difficult pitch, since everything would have to be given to us by God. But he pushes further. He says that the intellect is like a light from the light of God, and this light is how God knows himself and how the angels know him and so on. So let's pause there and pick that apart for a second. First, you have this idea that humans are given light from God's light. That's a very picturesque representation and for a very good reason. The first thing to note is that the idea of light is already understood to be symbolic of knowledge. In just about every language, light is understood to represent truth, because light illuminates. Things come to light, we are enlightened, ignorance is associated with darkness, to be in the dark, and so on. The second idea to note is that the giving of intellect to humans is using this illumination idea. How does the source of light give light to other objects? By shining on them. The objects that don't produce light can reflect the light, and this is the idea of moonlight, which is only reflected light. So the intellect of God shines forth, and we are the kind of thing that can reflect light, so we have it too. There are two neat things about this reflection idea. The first is that by reflecting light, we also become sources of illumination. First, we are able to light up our own way through the darkness, but then, if we shine brightly enough, we become like beacons of light for others as well. The second neat feature is that, like any reflective surface, one can make it more or less reflective depending on the care one takes of it. Here you have a lot of Sufi concepts like cleaning the dirt off your heart, polishing your character, etc. This is nothing new, except that Ibn Masadra is using the imagery not for the heart, which is the seat of emotions and spiritual purity, but for the head, the seat of reason. This image is what he spends the rest of the text trying to explain in greater detail. It's a demonstration of just how powerful the reflected light can be when the surface is properly polished and when the light is aimed in the proper direction. We'll get to what Ibn Masadra thinks of as the failure of philosophers later, but here it's worth taking a moment to tie these ideas into what we've already covered. Remember that the metaphysical idea is about properly orienting yourself and aiming for the highest moral value, and then exerting force to progress in that direction. Well, the orientation and the aim are the crucial features. If SpaceX aims one of their rockets the wrong way, no amount of thrust is going to get them to where they want to go. So the aim and orientation are critical. For Ibn Masadra, you can think of the idea as aiming the light one reflects in the correct direction, namely towards God. If you do that, then the path the light illuminates leads you towards God. Aim it at anything else, and you're ultimately moving in the wrong direction, though there are degrees of wrongness here. Finally, there's a line about how God knows himself through his intellect. That may seem oddly phrased, but that's primarily because A, we don't give any thought to how God knows himself, and B, because our concept of knowing yourself is a process of coming to know, and God is supposed to be inherently all-knowing, so no process. But this illumination idea that Ibn Masadra uses comes to the rescue. Let's think back to the sun and the moon. The moon sees the sun, so to speak, because the sun is giving off light. We see the moon because the moon is reflecting that light, and so on. The principle is that the source of light emission is what allows everything else to see the light source. Now, how does the sun see itself? What illuminates the sun? Well, the sun is self-illuminated. It is the source of light. So, by analogy, the sun sees itself by the same means that we see the sun, except that it has all the light and all we have is emissions and reflections. The same principle, different perspective. And since the sun is self-illuminating, there is no process of coming to see. Normally, light comes in from point A, bounces off of point B, and then we see it. But for the source of light, that process is actually gone, and the source of light is illuminated all at once. Next, Ibn Mas'udah cleverly demonstrates his point. He uses the Quran to back his claims, but at the same time, this shows you his point in a different way. His use of reason already illuminated the meaning of the verses. That is, he used inference to set up his point, to aim his light, and found from prophetic knowledge exactly what he was arguing, which is what his argument is ultimately all about. So, on one hand, he's explaining the argument. On the other hand, the very way in which he's explaining the argument is a demonstration of why he's correct. The verses he uses posit the idea that the whole world is signs pointing back to God, and those who properly consider those signs can understand them. Those who don't read the signs correctly go astray. Notice that the same applies to the earlier section. If you know how to properly unravel Ibn Mas'udah's ideas, they lead you to a particular conclusion, but if you read them in a shallow way, you just end up confused. And the verse he uses indicates that limiting yourself to a shallow reading, like viewing the world as purely materialistic, leads you astray. But how do we learn to see the world in more depth than that? Well, we use reason. The signs in the world are not part of prophetic knowledge. That is, they're not individually enumerated in the revelation. So it is the proper use of reason that will get you the correct reading. The next argument Ibn Mas'udah gives us is a seriously complex one. The prophets come with prophetic knowledge to clarify ideas with a certain set of signs. You can also think of this as the particularities of different prophets in context of their people, the specificity of miracles, and the emphasis on correcting the specific issues that the people have. But, Ibn Mas'udah points out, how are we supposed to comprehend those signs? We noted in our first session that you can't understand the message except by reason. And this is my source of that point. You just have to use reason to understand anything, including revelation. The prophetic knowledge comes in two varieties according to our metaphysical model: axiomatic and the world. This kind of presentation lets you examine both the internal coherence of the message, check if the axioms end up in contradiction, as well as external coherence, check if the ideas map onto the world. You also get theory and practice, but those are derivative of axioms. But notice that the entire process is dependent on your use of reason, and it seems to be intended that way. The prophets call people to an idea, they clarify the idea, and then they let the people decide. But you decide coherently only by reason. Sure, you could, quote, decide by emotion, but that's the opposite of reason. If the message calls on you to think, and you emotionally react instead, you're doing the opposite of what is asked, whether you accept or reject the message, by the way. This is especially true for considering the signs of creation which are not specifically enumerated in the prophetic pitch. Building off this idea and the concept of proper aim, Ibn Mas'udah goes back and reiterates the idea of inference, reason, and the prophetic knowledge. Inference works from the bottom up. Prophecy works from the top down. Now, the standard model may look something like this. Reason illuminates one thing, prophecy illuminates a whole different thing. But Ibn Mas'udah is arguing that the very notion of prophetic message requires that the two paths actually cross the same space. So you get something like this. Now, if he's correct, then the proper use of reason serves to first check the revelation. But then, in confirming that truth, the truth becomes entrenched into one's heart and mind, allowing you to perceive more deeply those things that are not apparent to the senses and are only accessible to the mind. This, for example, is the idea in perceiving a metaphysical reality. Since metaphysics don't have a physical reality you can experience by senses, they are known only by reason. And then, they're known to different degrees by different people, depending on the degree to which one has engaged with this kind of work. As an example, as I was writing my master's thesis, I was reading a lot of Islamic ideas on just war. At one point, I got stuck on this piece of Arabic terminology and how that worked with the other things that I'd read. And then I lucked out because I ran into a fairly famous Hafiz and a student of Tafsir by accident. This was in Bosnia. I didn't get to finish asking my question, and he knew exactly the verse and the word that was giving me the issue, and then gave me a lesson in linguistics, tafsir, and how the verse I was stuck on ties into a half dozen other ones, and how the language itself actually answers my question. At the end of that, I looked at him and said, "We're technically reading the same book here, but not really. What you see in it and what I see in it is entirely different." At which he kind of chuckled and nodded his head, because rather obviously, the depth at which he was reading it and the depth at which I was reading it are not really comparable things. I guess the same holds for any realm of focus study. I see more in any humanities text than people who study other fields. You may see more in programming code than I do. The information is all there, but the focus, which is the orientation and aim of our reason, means that a whole world of knowledge and understanding is hidden from me. And at the same time, if I only decided to turn my focus there, that once hidden knowledge would become apparent. However, the prerequisite for any of this is developing the use of reason, because reason is the same across all human endeavors, so you should study philosophy. And so Ibn Masadra points out that when revelation comes, we can't have a claim about its truth until we compare revelation to reason. If the two cover the same space as individual, then one confirms the other. But what if revelation and reason don't cover the same space? How could you then determine which religion, if any, is correct? Well, you could not. You may choose to believe it anyway, but there would be no coherent reason for you to accept any religion. More importantly, you could not be judged for having accepted or rejected any religion because you had no tools to make that decision. At this point, Ibn Masadra gives us this neat little experiment, and he works his way up from an observation of nature to the nature of God. Now, this isn't the only way to do this, and our science works a bit differently than his, because his science is 1,000+ years old, but the idea is kind of the same. He begins by noting that we see water moving up a plant. However, the nature of water is that it falls down. It does not spontaneously rise. That tells us that there is some kind of an external principle at play here, something that gets to override the nature of water. And this can't be in the nature of water, we know, because water in different settings acts differently. So it's not part of water, but a principle that acts on it. Next, he says, we notice that the elements and resources in a plant are distributed in such a way that, even though there's only four elements available, from his perspective, earth, air, fire, water, but if you thought about it in modern scientific terms, you'd have the same conclusion. The plant is composed of a number of very different and distinct parts, from roots in the trunk, branches to leaves, flowers and fruits, and that tells us that there's some kind of principle of resource distribution and use that governs the behavior of plants, and that principle cannot be in the elements which make up the plant, because these features are not experienced in any other instance of those elements. We know that the nature of matter is limited, and it acts in completely determined ways that are defined by their nature. This is just a recognition that mechanics are mechanical. Water falls, hence a waterfall. It can't decide to fall up this one time. To be determined also means that matter cannot act on its own. It is imposed on by some force external to it, which ultimately then governs how water will behave. In simple English, the rules of the universe dictate how matter in the universe behaves. Alternately, the rules of a computer program govern how the program will behave. Alright, so matter is limited. It's determined, it's dependent on external forces to govern and act on it. And that means that observation of the material world gave us a sign that there is another world that is the source of this one. It's more than matter, but rules matter. Thus, we move up a step from the material to the immaterial set of principles. That would be the rules and laws. Now, you'll notice that rules and laws only account for things like elements. But that's not enough to account for living matter. If living matter was so determined, then every living thing, or at least all members of the same species, would act identically, because it's the same matter, same principles. And at the same time, the mechanical principles are still in play when it comes to these living things, and that means that we need a concept that's in line with the mechanical part, but is above it, that discovers it in at least some existing entities, like humans and squirrels, and so we need to go up another level. And this leads us to what Ibn Masada is calling the animal spirit. Now we have something living, even by terminology. The animal spirit is less restrained or less constrained than matter and rules and laws because it has the power to allow for self-mobility. Think of a squirrel and a just dead squirrel. They are mechanically the same. The principles acting on the elements in its body are the same. So what's the difference? Well, one can move under its own power and the other one must be acted upon if it's to move. So matter can't move itself. A chair does not simply up and relocate. So it needs a source of power for motion. The animal spirit, Ibn Masada is arguing, is the source of such motion. The thing is, unlike the matter which it governs, the animal spirit is a substance. This distinction seems like a bit of a reach. Why is a substance somehow different than matter? Well, because we said so. In fact, this distinction is still used today by philosophers when talking about things like free will and determinism. By substance, Ibn Masada doesn't mean the modern version of the term, especially not in modern science. Instead, what he means is something like a uniform and indivisible whole. It has no parts, it simply is a force. So, the animal spirit grants the power to move a certain class of things. It is less limited than the rules and laws or matter, but it is not without limit. It experiences sleep, weakness, pain, moods, growth, age, excess and deficiency, and so on. Now, how do we know this? Because things that have animal spirit experience these limits. And those limits are not actually any kind of a property of matter or of universal laws. Water does not grow tired. It doesn't grow. The biggest limit in the animal spirit is that it lacks choice and freedom. We know that because animals act in a way that belies free will. No bee, squirrel, or ape go on to make a decision to become something other than the standard member of their group. This means that the animal spirit is itself governed by something else. How do we know? Well, every time you find something with limits, it is controlled by something with less limit. Matter is the most limited and is controlled by less limited universal laws. So following the chain of logic, we can only end our search when we find a set of principles that are without limit, because they are not controlled by something above them. So looking up from the animal spirit, we find signs that point to the idea of reason. Why reason or intellect? Well, one of the limits on the animal spirit was freedom and choice. So the thing that governs it must have freedom and choice. You can also look to the idea of higher animals, in this case humans. While all bees are alike, we pick and choose what we will do, how we will think, what we will act out, and so on. We do have some features that are found in lower animals as well, and this is well explained by the fact that we also have an animal spirit. Your reflexes, for example, are not a matter of choice in the moment, though you can manage to override them. If you touch something very hot, you don't have a discussion with yourself about what to do, you just react, and that's the animal spirit part of you. In examining the intellect, we find limits again. Intellect can be well aimed and oriented or poorly. It is affected by thoughts that come in from the outside. Do you ever think of something funny, usually at like the worst possible moment? Did you do that? Did you focus your intellect on coming up with a socially inappropriate joke? The power of the intellect grows and shrinks. We have no intellectual power at birth, then we develop these powers, they peak, and then they drop off with age, so on. So we need a level beyond the intellect, and that level needs to be free from these specific issues. It can't suffer from the problems of aim and direction, it can't grow or shrink, it needs to be stable, it can't be affected by anything outside of it. So such a level would also be the thing that determines everything else, including this sphere of the intellect. It must have power beyond all other levels. It must be the master level. Now this idea fits well with the Islamic concept of God. If you do a bit of digging, you'll notice that attributes like singular, all-powerful, all-knowing, etc. are inherently built into this kind of a conclusion. So this is what Ibn Masada calls God. And as far as he can see, this fits in completely with the Islamic ideas. And notice that getting there was an effort of reason, not of reliance on scripture. And so Ibn Masadr concludes that the use of reason must be legitimate. But as always, there's a catch. Philosophy uses reason like this, but philosophers have to decide which way to direct their use of reason. So now we're back to aim and orientation. Ibn Masadr says that most philosophers miss the point. They had great tools, but their orientation and aim was wrong. That's because they were focused on much more myopic ideas. Focusing instead on the idea of origin, which is inherent in the very fact of existence, would take you in the right direction. And to seal the point, Ibn Masadr leaves a throwaway line about the rational inference of God by Abraham, as he argues about what God is and is not, going from the stars, to the moon, to the sun, and finally arriving at the idea of God as accepted by Islam. Note that each step in the story has the same moving up pattern, as Ibn Masadr noted in his own argument. Start with something in your experience, then see how it is outdone by something else, then repeat the process until you find a level that nothing can be greater than. Also, this is sneaky. Notice that in the story, Abraham uses light as the means of identifying the divine, right? The different quantity of light emanating from the source. And the intellect Ibn Masadr pitched at the very beginning was pitched at light. That's a very neat full circle move on his part. The difference between reason and prophetic knowledge is that prophetic knowledge is something like guided philosophy. Instead of having to work your way up to the truth is given to you, and all you have to do is think about it a bit. Thus, the effort of Abraham produces the same core ideas as revelation, except that his effort is far more difficult than the guided version. So, can there be anything above the highest? Ibn Masadr says no. And why not? Well, there can't be anything above the highest that we can in any way infer, because the highest is the limit of inference. To have a concept of a thing is to have an intellectual representation of things that it represents, to think of an exemplar. But the highest does not have a genus that it belongs to. It is unique. It cannot be an exemplar because there is nothing else to exemplify. The idea of God is already above any form of complete conceptualization, aside from the kind of vague but necessary features of being limitless and so forth. If you think of conceptualization in terms of dogs, when I say dog, you just come up with whatever your preferred or most hated version of dog is. But if I were to say German Shepherd, you would have some sort of an exemplar image of a dog, particularly a German Shepherd, in your head. And that German Shepherd does not need to be one that you have ever actually seen. You just understand what are the features of a German Shepherd entirely, and thus you can envision what that animal would be like. But how can we know that there is a highest, since we can't even meaningfully conceptualize it? Ibn Masadr argues it this way. He says, nothing is self-subsistent. That is, everything depends on something else. That gives us the notion of a chain of dependence. But the chain itself inherently creates a need for the source of existence of everything else. The chain cannot go back indefinitely. That's called the reductio ad absurdum argument. If there is no source, then the process of everything else existing can't get started. Think of it this way. Let's say you see a long line of dominoes falling down one by one. Now, for any one domino, the reason why it moves is because the preceding one fell down. But can the line of dominoes stretch back into infinity? If it could, what started the dominoes falling? Well, it couldn't have been another domino, because then we need an explanation for that one. And so instead, you need something that is not a domino that started it. This is also called the cosmological argument. So if everything in the universe depends on other things for its existence, then there must be something not in the universe on which the universe itself is dependent, and without which the universe itself could not exist. Again, Ibn Masadr argues that reason alone, when correctly aimed and oriented, gives us all of this, and that this is in line with the prophetic knowledge and revelation. In fact, he argues that there is no revelation from God without an accompanying worldly sign, or vice versa. And this is because no prophetic message can be understood at all unless it is understood by reason. And so, in order for reason to make sense of revelation, the revelation and the world must be in sync. On to our second reading. You'll notice that the layout of What is Religion pitches it as something of a game, and that you have rules of the game and that your job is to simply follow the rules. This may sound a bit heretical in a particular way. However, if you consider Surah Asr, you notice exactly this. You have the very specific layout of rules. So it says that all humanity is at a complete loss, meaning that you're already engaged in a game and that the outcome is determined and it is negative. But you may be able to change that outcome if, and then there are 4 points, right? Believe and do good deeds, enjoin people to truth and enjoin them to patience. So that's literally the layout that you're seeing here. And notice again that this idea that your input has absolutely nothing to do with the situation is rather obvious. It says that all humanity is at a complete loss. Why? Can you do something about it? What if you don't like that ruling? And the answer is, does it look like anybody asked you what your opinion is? And the answer, of course, is no. So it's really important to wrap your head around understanding very personal ideas in a very abstract way like this, because that allows you to really get a handle on what's going on. All right, I realize that's a bit long and rather complex, but it is what it is. For next week, I will have another video up. In the meantime, I'm going to put up a Google document where you guys can all participate. It will just use one document going forth from here. And if you have any questions or any concerns or anything like that, just feel free to leave it there, and I will get to you as soon as I can.